From ABC, this is World News Tonight with Peter Jennings, reporting tonight from Berlin.
On the December of 1991, the Berlin Wall came crumbling down, and with it, the Soviet Union and its communist regimes, leaving only capitalism, victor of the ideological showdown that was the Cold War, in its wake.
It is these freedoms that have made America strong.
I promise this is relevant. I'm setting the scene.
Neoliberalism is a flavor of capitalism that is pro-deregulation, anti-welfare, and pro-austerity. So basically, the rich can do whatever they want. Fuck the poor. You don't deserve basic things like healthcare and food. But by this point, it had swallowed the world up in a frenzy. In the UK, Margaret Thatcher, our perhaps now second most infamous president, had just finished her third term, and just a year before, Ronald Reagan had finished his. Both of them were the forerunners of the modern neoliberal age, and ever since then, every single US president has been a neoliberal, and even the previously socialist left-wing Labour Party has drifted further and further right, giving way to neoliberal reforms. They had shifted the Overton window firmly to the right and cemented neoliberalism as the only option, with Margaret Thatcher herself even saying that there is no other alternative. But when we're talking about a system that has cost us over 50,000 deaths per year for over 5 years, is there really no alternative? Is this the best that we can do?
Is there really no alternative? In the past some hundred years, it seems that criticisms of capitalism have managed to break into the mainstream and garnered a real audience. Film after film have decried capitalism as a scam that hurts and destroys people, right from Death of a Salesman and The Great Gatsby.
No one ever anything but a hardworking drummer who landed in the ash can like all the rest of them.
All the way in the 50s, to Parasite and Squid Game just in the last years. There's a booming community online of people who make interesting critical works dissecting and criticizing capitalism. And that should be good, right? But it's hard to reconcile all of this art and this media that I love so much, that is so vital and radical and critical, with the harsh reality of an outside world that seems so unchanged by all of it. The world is clearly broken. We can all see it. So why won't anything change?
In Mark Fisher's Capitalist Realism, he grapples with these exact questions. But for sake of concision, I'm only going to talk about capitalist realism as it relates to media and to commentary. Basically, the problem with anti-capitalism is capitalism, or at least the commodification of anti-capitalism. Let's talk about online discourse for a start. I think a big problem in that regard is what I call the content factory. When your livelihood is connected to ad revenue and watch time and subscriber counts, you're under the same pressure as capitalists to produce, produce, produce. And I think that that can have detrimental effects on what actually is being produced, what's coming out of that, especially on platforms that demand consistency. I just feel like there's a tendency to just devolve into filler content, like think pieces about what Will Smith slapping Chris Rock says about society. I don't know, I think it's important that we're finally coming to the realization that, you know, people's actions don't exist in a bubble, but at the same time, I think it's so important to be able to look at things bifocally and understand that, yes, our actions don't exist in a vacuum, however, some things have bigger impacts than others, and we should treat them with that same, like, understanding of that same regard. The problem, though, isn't just that people can't look at things bifocally or don't know to do that. It's that it pays better not to. The problem is that activism and commentary has become so melded to content. But it's complicated because I do understand that these are people's livelihoods. But I don't know, it just feels really empty sometimes. At least for me,
So on Instagram, I have a series on Reels called Music Musings.
Welcome back to Music Musings, where I hear in your favorite songs for fun. Now, if there's anything that Alex Turner has always been good at, it's storytelling. He's got this terrific poem in YouTube.
And basically, the idea there is to just use that as a jumping off point to talk about, like, media theory and, like, sociological concepts more broadly. But I won't lie, it's so tempting to just devolve into, like, obvious, pointless commentary, like, you know, X generic pop song is actually misogynistic because that's what the content factory demands. But it's not interesting and it's not thought-provoking, it's not new or challenging. It's why I don't think I will ever make the part two to that one Ashniko reel. Sorry, I know I promised it, but I sat down to try to film it and I just couldn't. It felt like my soul was being destroyed. So, but anyway, anti-capitalism has become so normalized that it's not even subversive anymore. How many films and shows have you seen that have featured people corrupted by greed and money, where the rich billionaire is explicitly the bad guy? It's almost like shock therapy. The more these narratives are perpetuated and these stories are told, the less they anger us, because we know that by the end of the film, the bad capitalist will have been defeated by the good capitalist. The bad autocrat will have been defeated by the good one. Capitalism isn't the problem, it's crony capitalism. Tony Stark is the perfect example of this, but I mean, even if you just think about the fact that Disney, the literal embodiment of everything wrong with capitalism, makes films that seem to criticize capitalism, it's right there. Capitalism goes where the money goes. And if anti-capitalism is what sells, if feminism is what sells, then they will sell you a fake and empty version of it. And you could make the argument that those are liberal critiques of capitalism. You know, what about actual fundamental criticisms? And as much as I love genuinely provocative social films and edutainment more broadly, it has a similar problem. Films like Squid Game, The Hate U Give, hell, even The Joker, problematic as it is, have the same problem. And that's because they end. And there's a nice, neat little resolution, balance is restored, the anguish and the pain the film showed you is all but gone. Evil is defeated and you get that nice feeling of catharsis, like, I can relax now. And you might be sad and think about it for a little bit. Maybe watch a few essays on it, or, I don't know, dress up as the character from it for Halloween, thereby following the same hyper-consumerism the show criticizes. But eventually, you forget, and you move on. As someone who tries to be creative and tries to make socially conscious art, it's a question I keep coming back to. Does art have to look like this? How do you make good art and good commentary that people just can't look away and move on from? How do you haunt people? I was lucky enough to be able to work with a team of amazing young people on this. A play called Like There's No Tomorrow. It's about the climate crisis. And as you can imagine, this was a question that we really, really struggled with. And the question of how to end the play without devolving into blind optimism, but also not being doomerist. And our solution was to have a non-ending, a beginning to the end, but far from the actual end of things. And I think it's very important that we did that. But sometimes I also feel like the endings to social commentary has to be sad. It has to be infuriating and full of injustice for it to actually be effective, because I don't know, maybe that way it'll stay longer. Maybe that way it'll linger in your mind. I really don't know. But other parts of the way the stories work, the focus on single people and their experiences, can also make making
like narrative social commentary that is good a little bit more difficult, especially when it comes to tackling like systemic issues, because how do you explore entire complex vast systems through the experience of just one person? It's not impossible, but it is difficult. Yeah. I'm not trying to plunge you into the pits of despair, and I don't think that doomerism is helpful at all, but at the same time, I want us to be wary of blind optimism. Things are really bad. They are. But that just means that the battle is half fought. That just means that you need to... That just means that after you've rested, healed, recharged, you need to go back out there and continue that battle, because it's only half fought. Look in your local community. Is there anything that needs doing? Any way that you can help to make, any way that you can volunteer your time or money or efforts to make real concrete social change? I always struggle with concluding essays. How do you summarize such like complexity into a single neat little sentence? But I've been starting to think that maybe I shouldn't. Maybe all I can ever really say is, here's what I learned, that's what I think. What about you? I'm back. This is like the third video I've tried to film, like coming back. So much has happened. I don't even want to explain. But yeah, this has been really good. Hopefully it turns out okay. You can and should follow me on Instagram. I make stuff there, like the Real series I mentioned sometimes. Yeah, it's also, you can also like recommend me like video topic ideas and stuff in like my stories. So I would recommend that. I've also started article writing. I think I'm a lot more fluent in writing, and I'm pretty proud of some of the stuff that I've written, so I would really recommend checking out my articles. I'll put one on the screen that I think you might like if you enjoyed this video.